Good morning, church. This morning, Kavi suggested, why, uncle, every time in the church hall and the stage, why don't you find a different locations? So then I found this is the best way. I'm standing outside the church hall in the compound, an empty, abandoned premises. It's not a good news, but I'm standing in that place in a faith that God will soon let us come back to this place, and once more his place will be filled with God's people. Now, as pandemic thing is getting worse and worse, and today's count is 67,000 in one day count, which is the highest. So things are bad. At the same time, this morning we come to a God who is in control of all things. Before we come to worship, I want to read Psalms 73 verse 1 and 2, and one more verse. Verse 1 and 2 says, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in his heart, in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold, for I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. So here Psalmist is saying, he almost slipped. Slipped in what? Slipped in his faith. Slipped in faith, in his faith in God. Why? Because he looked at the prosperity of the wicked. Why this wicked are prospering and I'm loving God and I'm trusting God, and why nothing is happening to me? So he says, almost I slipped. But verse 17 he says, till I entered the sanctuary of God, then I understood their final destiny. Church, this morning, let's not look around. Let's look up. So this morning, as Stanley leads into worship, let's look up. Our God is on the throne. He deserves our worship. Over to Stanley.
Good morning, church, and welcome this morning. I just want to read a psalm for all of us. Psalm 30:11. Hear me, O Lord, and have mercy. O Lord, be my helper. You've turned my mourning into dancing. You peeled off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, that my heart may sing your praises and not be silent. O Lord, my God, I will give you thanks forever. Yeah. You know the story of Lazarus. And Jesus comes on the fourth day and he says, Lazarus, come forth. And he comes out of the grave. This morning, if you call on the name of Jesus, your situations like grave will be turned into glorious day. Amen. So we're going to sing this song, Glorious Day. Let's start it. Let's put our hands together. Thank you. shake at the weights of your glory. I needed shelter and I was orphaned. Someone called me a citizen of heaven. And I was broken, you were my healing. Your love is there and it's here that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open. This morning we want to sing this. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Let's take it up. Turn into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. And I like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. And I like you.
And if
I got us for us, and who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who can stand again? And if our God is for us, who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, who can stand again? And if our God is for us, who could ever stop us? And if our God is for us, who can stand again? Yeah, stand again. You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Hallelujah. Healer, greater, our God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Lord, this morning, we come to your throne of grace. Oh, you are a great God. At the mention of your greatness, in your name, all the knee will bow down. Lord, your glory would fill this place this morning as we worship. Because you have overcome. And you have chosen us, and your church as your people. Now this morning, we want to say that, Lord, for you, wear the victor's crown. You are Jesus, the Messiah. You're the hope of the world. Lord, even during this time, tough times, Lord, we want to look at your face. Hallelujah, and sing. You wear the victor's crown. For us, heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender. You're my savior and my friend. By your grace I'll live and greatness, your name will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this temple, let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you.
Jesus, you ever.
are ever interceding. You are ever interceding at the lost become the found. You can never be defeated, for you wear the victor's crown. You're the Jesus, the Messiah. You're the hope for all the world. By the grace I live and breathe to worship you. Hallelujah.
Everybody sing, I exalt thee, we exalt you.
Lord, are high above all the earth, for thou art exalted far above all gods. For thou, O Lord, art high above all the earth, and thou art exalted far above. Glorified in our lives, Lord. Lord, when we sing praises to you, Lord, the presence of glory, the presence of your glory will come down. The Shekinah glory of God would definitely encompass us, all our people and church. Lord, I pray that your presence will be our portion, our protection. Lord, your presence will be our providence, that we always would like to be under the shelter of the Almighty God. Lord, this morning we want to worship God Yahweh, the true and living God, Yeshua, Jesus, the Messiah. Holy Spirit of God, we thank you this morning. We worship you, Lord. Lord, even as we listen to your word, with this attitude, I pray that your word will speak to us, challenge us to live an upright, godly life, to live a life with joy. Jesus, you will be the first, and Lord, others would be second, and ourselves would be last, Lord. Jesus, we thank you. We ask this in the matchless and the miraculous name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Stanley, for leading us in this lovely worship this morning. Let's continue to look up and keep our eyes on him. So shall we bring our tithe and offering to the Lord? Bible says God loves the cheerful giver. There's nothing about giving God cheerfully. You know, we have to go one step ahead. Anyway, all that we have is from him. So what is that to cheerfully give Him? Whatever we give is His anyway. All the blessing that we have is His anyway. So this morning, let's give God what belongs to Him, the tithe and offering, beyond our cheerful heart, right? So let's bring our tithe and offering and let me pray. So you can, as usual, hold it in your hand and pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. Lord, we could come and worship you and give you the glory and honor and make your heart glad this morning by worship. We also bring our tithe and offering as part of our worship. Receive them, Lord. Receive them, Lord. Father, all that we have is from you, Lord. So, Father, nothing that we do is anything that we are doing sacrificially. Lord, what can we compare to what you have done for us? So, Lord, the little amount that we bring, receive them, Lord. We also pray, may your favor be upon us. May your favor be continually be upon us. So, Lord, we commit this offering and tithe before you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So today's topic, Kavi will bring today's message. So let's listen to him.
Greetings, church. Anna and I were talking to one of our friends last week, and we asked them, which church do you attend during the season? And he very jokingly said, Bedside Baptist Church. So I'm not sure if you're a Bedside Baptist or a coffee shop Calvinist, but I pray that wherever we are this morning, that God's word will transform us. So we are on a journey through the book of Philippians, and as a church, we've themed the entire series as how to be joyful always. So last week, David Uncle and Pradeep, they took us through chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. And today, Anna and I will take us through chapter 3, verses 12 to 21. I requested Samuel Auntie to read the text for us today, so let's welcome Samuel Auntie.
Philippians 3, 12 to 21. Know that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. All of us who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join with others in following my example, brothers, and take note of those who live according to the pattern we gave you. For as I have often told you before and now say again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is on earthly things, but our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body.
So verses 12 to 21 has many themes, and we won't be doing justice if we try and address them all in the short time we have today. So Anna and I, we have decided to focus on verses 12 to 17. So by now we all know that Paul is writing from house arrest in Rome. He is no more a free man. He's a prisoner of the Roman Empire. And most of his time he is chained to a Roman Praetorian guard. And despite his condition, the central theme to the letter to the Philippians is joy. In verses 17 he writes, "Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters. Join together in following my example." In 1 Corinthians 11:1, he says, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." If we follow Paul's example, we can learn how to be joyful no matter what our circumstance is. So in the current condition of COVID and all that it entails, our freedom may be taken away, our finances may be gone, our careers may be uncertain, and our bodies might be giving way. So no matter what your condition is today, if we follow Paul's example, we can remain joyful. So the title we've given today's message is Paul, a Model for Joy. Paul, a Model for Joy. We have four keys for you today, and I want to welcome Anna to come and take us through the first two keys. So Anna, welcome.
Good morning, church. Are there any book lovers around here? I know there are. Would you know by any chance what is last, or which book on Amazon India was last week's bestseller under the category of health, family, and personal development? It's a book called Ikigai, The Japanese Secret to a Long and Happy Life. I haven't read the book myself, but a lot of bloggers, Instagrammers, and people I follow on social media recommend it. The Japanese word ikigai is used to describe a reason to get out of bed every morning or a reason for being. According to the book, ikigai is a place where your desires, your needs, and your ambitions and satisfactions are met. And when you have your ikigai, you, as a person, are happy and successful. There are so many out there looking to find meaning beyond the mundane, to feel purposeful in life, to live a joyful life. And the world offers a whole platter of solutions. With every swipe on a phone, there's a motivational speaker around the corner with quotes that are just what you need to hear, that are Instagram worthy, that could be on a bumper sticker or on a t-shirt. One of the most common ones these days are, "I am enough." And another popular one, "I am perfect." It especially pops up on special occasions like Mother's Day and Women's Day and Father's Day and all these days. You'll see it strewn across social media, motivational speeches, and even on children's books. The minute we look at social media, we're surrounded by self-proclaimed or media-acclaimed influencers or experts. There are, in every field you'd see, there are experts promoting their accomplishments. The best way to toilet train your one-year-old, the perfect face mask for acne, the must-have list of books for your three-year-old to learn how to dissect a frog, or the best way to fold your clothes and organize your fridge, or how to find your perfect partner. In contrary to ikigai, Paul in Acts chapter 17 verse 28 says that it is in Christ that we live, move, and have our being. So that brings us to our first point, an honest evaluation of ourselves. And this requires great humility. In Philippians 4:12, and then again in verse 13, Paul gives us his bottom line, that he hasn't arrived. He isn't perfect. He hasn't attained full Christ-likeness. He doesn't have it all together. And all the reasons for self-confidence that he lists out in the previous verses of chapter 4, he says that they mean nothing. He throws them in humble revelation of the fact that he is not perfect. And Paul, of all people, had every reason to be a self-proclaimed influencer or expert. He not only humbles himself, but clearly states the reason that he has zest for living, the reason to wake up, get out of bed every morning, the reason to press on. And that is the fact that he is not his own, but Christ Jesus. Again, he reminds us of Acts chapter 17, verse 28, where he says, after it is in Christ that we live and move and have a being, he says that we are God's offspring. That is, we are God's own. As Christians, especially if we've been Christians for many years, we can often slip into a pool of self-righteousness, giving others the impression that we have it all together, that we have no doubts, that we are kind of perfect. We feel, we believe, or, you know, we act or give an appearance that we know it all. We have heard it all. We become experts on how to preach, how to pray, how to understand the Bible. But here we have Paul as a great example, saying that to be joyful truly, it starts from being aware of ourselves, of our limitations, of our inadequacies, of our weaknesses, of our failures, and of our sins. Some years ago, we had the privilege of having our Uncle L.T. Jayachandran stay with us when we were living in Harbin in a little tiny apartment. And during conversation, I asked him, Uncle, aren't you tired of so many meetings and speaking assignments, and, you know, you have to go to so many groups and little gatherings? Doesn't it exhaust you? Because he was, you know, in his early 70s at that time. And he said, no, it doesn't. Being with the younger generation rejuvenates me. It's not always me imparting, but through all the time I learn as well. He didn't place himself on a high horse, looking down on us and talking to us or preaching to us. And after spending time with him, you know, knowing what he knows, he had all the reason to be on that high horse. And that for me is really great humility. If our self-confidence stems out of, or self-esteem or self-worth stems out of, you know, where we come from, our wealth, our caste, our achievement, our physical appearance, our family name, our social standing, our popularity, the number of likes we have on Instagram, it cannot be permanent, because all that is passing away. And only the Word of God remains. As a parent, I have come to understand that apart from Christ, I can do nothing. And that my children need to see that. That the strength in me is not my own, but Christ's. So I say that I am not enough, but God is. The next step is to forget what lies behind. Philippians 4 verse 13b, it says, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind. God asks us to forget all the old and former things in Isaiah chapter 43 verse 18. It's not easy to forget, or maybe for some it is. But what it really means is that not letting the past have control over you or manipulate you. The two things we need to forget if we are to follow Paul's pattern to live a joyful life is that, number one, we need to forget our past sins and failures. God sets the first example by forgetting our sins no more in Hebrews 10 verse 17. He doesn't hold that over our heads. And in Hebrews 12 verse 1, it tells us to throw off all that hinders us and sin that entangles us. Satan is great at using our past as a weapon against us to steal, to kill, to destroy our life and our joy. Moving on is really hard when there's the weight of guilt, the weight of past failures, memories that are not helpful, when those are weighing you down. It's hard to run a race. And we not only need to forget our past sins and failures, but we also need to forget our past successes. Now, Paul is an old man in prison. He's accomplished so much for Christ. He's, you know, been around the Mediterranean Sea and planted churches, done miracles, written down letters and epistles, and he has suffered for Christ. Yet he says, all that is to be forgotten. He knows that he needs to keep growing. And to continue growing, that cannot happen if he settles in his glory days. He isn't bringing up how good life was in the, you know, how great life was in the good old days. But rather, while in prison, he's still speaking of growth and living a joyful life, of still running and pressing on in the race. Success tends to make us complacent and also fills us with pride. And when we are filled with pride, we stop growing. Jesus uses very strong words in Luke chapter 9, verse 62, when he said that anyone who keeps looking back is not fit for the kingdom of God. And that is strong, is not fit for the kingdom of God. Lot's wife found it hard not to look back at Sodom, a city of wretched depravity. And she turned into a pillar of salt. There is so much of enticement that the world offers, but all those pleasures are transitionary, and the things of this world cannot grow strangely dim if we are constantly looking backwards. In the words of Elsa from Frozen, let it go. While we are asked to forget, it also goes with remembering. Remembering who we are in Christ. Remembering that we were once wretched people, but bought with the precious blood of Christ to be his, to be Christ. And that is also what Paul gives us as his motivation to run the race, to press on, that he is not his own, but he belongs to Christ. So what do we forget, and what do we remember? John Piper puts it in this simple way: forget everything that hinders your faith and obedience, and remember everything that serves your faith and obedience. I want to close with questions to ask ourselves. What memory do I need to get rid of, or do I need to let go? Am I wallowing in my past failures rather than trusting God for my future? Or am I stuck in my past successes rather than confessing the need to be transformed?
Thank you, Anna, for taking us through those 2 points. So thus far, we've looked at how Paul humbly evaluates himself, how he does not dwell on his gloomy days or his glory days. But if all we do is forget our past, then we just have amnesia. You know, one of the signs of spiritual maturity is that we look forward rather than constantly look backward. Joyful people focus on the future and they press on. That brings us to point number 3, which is determination. Verse 13, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on toward the goal. I forget the past and I'm straining toward what is ahead. I'm pressing on towards my goal. Here is an image of a runner in the games. You know, he is extended in every fiber of his being. I press on literally means I pursue, I persecute until I reach my goal. In the Christian life, we can't afford to give up. Do you remember the story of the old story of the hare and the tortoise in the race? The hare starts well, is going fast, and then is probably overconfident, decides to take a nap under the tree, whereas the tortoise keeps going on and on and on until the finish line. We need to be like the tortoise. Nothing could stop Apostle Paul. He had almost everything thrown against him. I want to read for you from 2 Corinthians 11:24 onwards. 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 I was shipwrecked. 1 night and 1 day I was adrift at sea. On frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from the Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and in exposure. And apart from other things, there is the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. All this and more could not stop Apostle Paul. straining towards, he says. Can you feel the intensity? I'm straining towards what is ahead. I overextend myself. I'm giving all that I have to go forward, he says. Apostle Paul was not a man who would give up easily. He was determined. He was a man of intensity, maximum effort, and determination. I want to tell you the story of a man by the name Henry Wanyoike. At 21, Henry Wanyoike appeared to be headed for a bright future as one of Kenya's running superstars. He had a 5-kilometer time of 13 minutes and 50 seconds. This was just less than 10 seconds away from the 2012 Olympic gold medal time. Then, all of a sudden, overnight, he had a stroke and he lost his sight. He became blind completely. Depressed and disillusioned, Wanyoike drifted for the next few years. But he eventually decided to go to the school for the blind. And someone in the school who knew of his running past urged him to take on running again. When he first started running again, he fell down. He stumbled and he fell. Even with guides to help him, he fell. He was afraid. But within a few years, after much struggle and determination and training, Wanyoike had set world records in the Paralympics in both the 5 kilometers and the 10 kilometers. He kept on breaking his records, which were world records themselves. Wanyoike has since held political office and had established a foundation for the disabled in Kenya. Let's watch a short clip of Henry Wanyoike.
I lost my sight when I was 21 years, and this was due, I had a mouth stroke which affected my optic nerves. In fact, it just happened like one night I went to bed, and the next day I could not be able to see again. So it just happened all of a sudden, not always in the beginning. I had to be living in a self-denial. I was in great shock. I was living a depressed life. And even like, I had to lose many friends when I lost my sight because I could not be able to understand what has happened to me.
The loss would be the beginning of a long journey for the then young man who would later beat the odds and grow into the glare of global fame. Today, he represents hope and success.
Henry Wanyoike is a person who doesn't give up so easily. And after my victory in Sydney, I was very, very happy to see that I can make it, because my dream when I was a young boy was to become a world champion. As you know, in Kenya, we produce so many good athletes. And I was admiring some of our good athletes. And I was saying that one day, I love to see my story in the school books. I want to see myself having a good welcoming at the airport. So this and putting Kenya on the map, this is something which I was dreaming to become when I grow big. And so I'm very happy that it has happened.
Henry Wanyoike was determined to get to his goal. Let us not quit because of our past. Let us not quit because of our present circumstances. And also let us not become complacent and stop growing. Stop moving forward for what God has for us in our lives. Paul is moving forward. He is determined. He is not aimlessly running. He is pressing on towards a goal. That brings us to point number four. Point number four is concentration. Focus. Paul is focused. He is concentrated on reaching his goal. Verse 12, "But I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me." And verse 14, "I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Paul was focused. He is straining towards and pressing towards a goal to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of him, to win the prize that God had called him heavenward in Christ. You know, in the video, Wanyoike said this. He said, My dream as a young boy was to become a world champion. He wanted to become a world champion and nothing could stop it. He didn't have shoes and clothes, he tells in the story, you know. But that didn't stop him. Blindness couldn't stop him from getting to his goal. He had a goal. He wanted to become the world champion. His dream kept him going. With his sight gone, yes, he was afraid. He was crippled. But soon he learned that there was something far more important than sight. Henry Wanyawike said, "Vision is more powerful than sight." Vision is more powerful than sight. He had a dream. He had a goal. We need to cultivate our vision. We need to have our eyes fixed on the author and finisher of our faith. To be joyful, we need to be focused. Even in the hard times, we need to be focused. You know, sometimes a thing is all the more impressive when it's left undescribed. Paul, in this text, he does not tell us what his goal is or what the prize is. But from Scripture, we can glean some of his goals and probably some of the prizes he expected when he met the Lord. Let me just take you through a few of his goals and maybe a few of the prizes he envisioned. Goals. The first one is 1 Corinthians 9:19. He says, "Though I am free and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible for Christ." To win as many as possible, one of his goals. Second, 2 Corinthians 5:9. He says, "So we make it our goal to please him, to please Christ, whether we are at home in the body or away from it." Number three, Philippians 3:10. He says, "I want to know Christ." We saw this text last week. "I want to know Christ, whether it be in the power of his resurrection or sharing in the fellowship of his sufferings." And 3:14, he wants to win the prize. Even the prize is a goal for him. Now let us look at some of the prizes he probably envisioned. Luke 19:17. He probably wanted to hear from God, "Well done, well done." 2 Timothy 4:8. He says, "Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing." Another prize. 1 Peter 5:4. "And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away." And in his own words in 1 Corinthians 2:9, he says, maybe the prize is this: "What no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him." I hope you noticed, at the heart of all his goals is Christ. To win as many for Christ. To please Christ in every way. To know Christ. What is our goal this morning? What is your goal? Are we just coasting through life like a ship without a rudder? Paul was not coasting. He had a goal in mind and he was pressing on towards it. We can't afford to be casual with the time that the Lord has given us. Rick Warren says, "The only way you are coasting is when you are going downhill." And if you're coasting in your life right now, that means you are going downhill. Earlier in Philippians, Paul writes, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." If we live for anything in this world as our main consuming passion, then to die is all loss. If our consuming passion is Netflix, we can binge-watch shows for many hours straight. Our consuming passion can be our own family. It can be our careers. It's not wrong, but I'm saying if that is our consuming passion, then to die is all loss. If we live for this world, then as the years go by, Our future becomes darker and darker because our remaining years left become lesser and lesser. We feel that life is closing in on us, and the things that really matter to us, that is, whatever I mentioned, if that is your consuming passion, and if that's what really matters to you, these things are getting further away from you and further away from you as you grow old. And then at one point, they are out of your reach altogether. On the other hand, if we live for Christ, if Christ is our consuming passion, if we press on like Paul to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of us, then our future will be bright. As our remaining years get less and less, and we become aware of the limitations of time, then we are only getting closer towards the prize for which we have been living for. This is how we grow with joy. How to endure illness with joy. How to live in difficult circumstances with joy. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What is our goal this morning? What is our consuming passion this morning? Is it Christ? Is it Christ? Do we want to make him known? Do we want to know him? Do we want to win as many as possible for him? Is Christ our passion? In conclusion, the 4 points are a humble evaluation of yourself. Elimination, that is, forgetting your past, failures, and the successes. Then determination to be able to press on through our life, not to give up. And finally, to focus on the goal. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. May the Lord who has called us keep us and keep us going and direct our path. May God bless you. Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you. The Lord, your word is always before us to warn us, to encourage us, to show us the way, and keep us standard for us. Lord, we tend to distract. We tend to get distracted from our course. But Lord, your word always warns us and reminds us. Thank you for reminding us this morning that Lord, you are there. And you have chosen us, and our future is in your hands. Help us, O Lord, to forget the past, our success and our failures, our shortcomings, our weaknesses, and even forget our achievements. So, Lord, we will not focus on us and our surrounding today, but Lord, we will focus on you and the call that you have given to us, and focus on your plans and purposes this morning. Help us to press on towards the goal that you set before us, Lord God. Lord, you are all in all. You are the most precious one. You're the most, Lord, the deserving one. So, Lord, your call, your plans, your goal for us, they are the best. Help us to understand that and press on towards the goal in spite of all unfavorable circumstances. We commit our lives to you. We commit our church into your hands. We commit all our families into your hands. We commit all our children and our individual singles into your hands. May the favor of the Lord be upon us. Lord, in this uncertain circumstances, Lord, we will not lose out our focus. Help us in Jesus' name. We ask this. Amen. Amen. Thank you, friends. God bless you. Have a nice weekend.